Hello everybody and welcome to this tutorial. Today I will continue with the installation of Kali Linux within a virtual environment. You might have noticed that I have two screens on which it is written Kali Linux, and they are exactly the same except one has a bigger font and a zoomed in picture, so to say. So over here on the left side, this is my virtual machine, the window that I'm moving now. This is the actual virtual machine. And the window on the right side, that is just a zooming in app that I have installed in order for you to be able to better see what I am about to show you here, primarily because I don't have guest editions installed on the virtual machine, and you cannot install them until you actually install the operating system first. Therefore, I can't zoom in anything, I cannot perform any operations of a kind, and you can see that the font on the left side is rather small and a bit difficult to see. Therefore, I will perform the work there on the left side, and you can monitor what I am doing on the right. There is no difference between left and right in terms of actions, only in terms of font size. Anyway, I'm just going to go ahead and scroll down to install. Press enter. That is what we want. And the installation procedure is underway. By the way, if you boot into live version, the password for the default password for root is just root in reverse, so D-O-O-R. Just a bit of a brief mention there, a bit of extra info that I wanted to throw in there, might come in handy from time to time. Anyway, pick whatever language is suitable for you. You can also pick the uppermost option where it says see no localization. So if you want a greater degree of anonymity or something of a kind, you can even pick that, but for the sake of this tutorial there really isn't any need. And even if you do pick a language, I mean, a lot of people pick English, so that will not footprint you or anything of a kind. So just press enter. And here you can actually choose a country, territory, or area. Well, I don't know, you can choose whatever you want here. I'm just going to go ahead and click UK because it immediately offers me a British keyboard that I use. So that's very nice in terms of settings. But again, you could have chosen no localization and this, you would not be asked any of these things. Well, for keyboard you probably would, but for the country, area, or anything of a kind, you would not. In any case, even if you don't pick the right one here, it doesn't matter. Later on, after the installation, you can configure it any way you like. But it's very nice to do it straight away. It saves a bit of work later on. Anyway, the installation is now underway. I'm just going to unbind my mouse. Seems to get stuck in a loop there. Basically, you bind and unbind your keys by simply pressing the right control key. That is how you control the mouse. Oops. Just move this a bit so you can see it a bit better. Expand. Nope. There we go. Anyway, there's some auto configuration going on now. Nothing really noteworthy, so to say. Let me just change this a bit. There we go. And you can pick a host name here, unless you have some sort of specific preferences, or you actually have a registered host name or something of a kind, which you do not want to use here, by the way. You can just leave it as default. You can type in you can leave Kali, or you can actually write whatever you want your computer to be called. So I'm just gonna leave it default, but you can, as I said, you can write whatever you wish to write there, no problems. So let's just go onto the continue. By the way, you don't have a mouse option here while you're doing this installation, so pressing tab switches between fields and options. If you press space, that means you're marking the field. And tab means switching fields. So use tab, space, and enter to actually call a function to execute something. In this case, I'm just going to say continue. Here you can type in your domain name. No, I do not want the domain name at this time. Keep in mind that you can configure this later on as well should there be a need for it. Just click on continue or hit enter. Now, root password, I would suggest picking something ridiculously complex and complicated. And a lot of people worry that they won't remember their passwords if they're long and complicated or something of a kind. But assign a certain logic to your password, something that reflects the way you think. And then the password can gain on length and you can still manage to remember it. So for example, you can insert a certain word that you use or that you're attached to or something like that, something that you like, but you don't need to type the word, you don't need to spell the word correctly in English language. Rather, instead you can type, spell it incorrectly and then add, I don't know, like exclamation marks, question marks, greater than signs, lesser than signs, at sign, and so on and so forth. But figure something that reflects your logic, your way of thinking, and make sure that it is above 8 characters. Like, above 8 characters is a must-have. It needs to contain capital letters, a few of them, not just one. You need also a different form of signs. You cannot use just one sign. That's not a good idea. You need to use like 3 or 4 of them in a mixture. The more the better, and don't just type in a word in English language and then type in numbers and then type in signs. So you are already assigning a very strict order, so any brute forcing attack will go much easier if you do something like that. Rather, instead, try to have a mixture, try to randomize the position of the types of characters that you're going to put in your password. Give some thought to this. Don't just type in something at random. Don't just type in something easy here. Just give some thought to it. For the time being, for the sake of this tutorial, I'm going to use one of the dumbest passwords possible. I'm going to type in test. That's going to be the password of this virtual machine. And I'm going to hit the continue button. But as it's going to ask you to verify it by forcing you to re-enter it. And there we go, it's going. But once again, I emphasize, use a strong password, above 8 characters plus, with characters and capital letters as well. So now we have partitioning methods, and if this was my main machine, if this was my host machine, I would definitely do this manually. I would want my partitions to be configured in a certain way, but since this is a virtual machine, I'm just going to go ahead and say guided use entire disk. It doesn't matter to me as there is only one partition anyway. And it's 138 gigs. It's pretty much better like this as we don't really have any legit need for anything of a kind unless we wanted to set some sort of encryption or something of a kind. Press enter. All files in one partition. Recommended for new users. Sure, we can do that. You can separate home partition. You can separate all of these partitions. For example, this is something that I did on my host machine. You have a lot of things that are separate, and my main drives are also fully encrypted. So it would even if I lost my laptop or it got stolen, it would be really difficult to access pretty much anything. Even the BIOS is locked, so you can't even reinstall it. You would literally have to open up the laptop, take the BIOS battery out, which is underneath my main processor, and you're more likely to basically permanently damage the motherboard than you are to actually remove and put back that battery in order to reset the BIOS. That's one of the very nice fail-safes for devices, especially for compact laptops. But in this case, we don't need any of that, primarily because such configuration and such things are done on the host machine. You encrypt your partitions there, you lock the BIOS there, and so on and so forth. While on the other hand, with virtual machines, there's no need to do anything of a kind, primarily because the host machines are the fail-safe. If that fails, everything else will fail. So you don't need to worry about it. You don't need to add those unnecessary layers, I would say, primarily because they're going to slow you down in the greater scheme of things. So press enter, finish partitioning, and write changes to disk. Before I do that, let me just go ahead and explain the partitioning scheme here, or partitioning layout here. So you have primary hash 1 primary 126.5 gigabytes space F space ext4 space slash. Now all these things have a meaning, but what you need to know is that, like in Windows, you have NTFS partitioning, NTFS partitions. In Linux, you have ext4 partitions. They are a bit faster. That's one thing that goes in the favor of Linux. And you also, during the partitioning during the partitioning of the disk with a Linux system, there is only one partition which is a must-have, which is an absolute requirement, and that is this first partition that I have selected. Its markation is just slash. That is the root partition, and you always need to configure it. Always. Without it, manual partitioning will not work. You will get error messages saying that you must specify a root partition. Down below, we have swap. Swap is basically a fail-safe method. So when you run out of RAM memory, you basically tell your system, okay, you can have this portion of the hard drive and you can use it as RAM, which functions in a very slow manner, but it will prevent your machine from crashing. Usually swap partitions are configured to the double size, they are the double size of your RAM. My RAM is 8 gigabytes, but here by default the computer has assigned 4 because this is a virtual machine, and if you remember at the beginning I have assigned 2 gigabytes of RAM to this virtual machine, so it has just multiplied it by 2. It wasn't exactly 2, it was just above 2, and it has multiplied it by 2, so I get 4.3 gigabytes of swap space. Now, on most of the modern systems, on most of the modern computers, you will not require swap partitions. Even though if you don't make it, you'll get a warning, but rare are the cases when you will need a swap partition, when you will waste all 8 gigabytes of RAM or something of a kind. I mean, it happens to me from time to time, but usually if it happens, there's something wrong with the system. I don't want it to continue consuming resources. I want it to stop there. Anyway, now that you know that what some of the options here mean, you have markation for the disk here. It's SDA, but we'll get into that later as we configure the system. So you also have some other options here. It says configure encrypted volumes, configure logical volume manager, LVM, configure RAID, and you can go back to guided partitioning. So these are all very nice options that come for free, and you might think, oh well, that's no big deal or something of a kind, but believe me when I tell you, these things in proprietary operating systems, they cost a lot of money, while here they are free and generally work better. What we will be interested today will not be RAID because we don't actually need it. You can configure encrypted volumes as well. I will demonstrate at a later time encryption methods. You don't need to encrypt your volumes in a virtual machine, but you can encrypt certain files or folders if you don't want to grant access to them. However, my hard drives here on my host machine are encrypted, so I am pretty safe in that regard. I'm just going to go ahead now to the bottom. Press enter and finish partitioning and write changes to disk. Excellent. So now, oops, let me just move this a little bit so you can see it. Basically, it is asking me for a confirmation. So if you continue, the changes listed below will be written to disks. Otherwise, you will be able to make further changes manually. Now, it is informing me of the changes to be made and telling me basically that all the information will be lost should there be anything there? And you can see that by default, it is set to no so that you don't press enter by mistake and erase pretty much all the data on your disks, because this installation, this ISO file that you're installing, it does not know that it is being installed on a virtual machine on which nothing pretty much exists and there is nothing to be lost. So write changes to disks. Yes, go ahead and continue with the procedure. It is now the installation process is now underway, and this is gonna take a while, I can tell you that much. So while this is going on, I just wanna go ahead and pause the video here and finish this tutorial. In the next tutorial, once the installation is complete, I will actually get into Kali, start configuring it, and introduce you to its interface. In any case, I bid you farewell, and I hope to see you all in the next tutorial.